Alrighty. Good evening, everybody. How you guys doing?
Doing good.
Doing well. Good to hear. See if this mic is alright. You guys can hear me in the back? Yep. Okay, great. Alrighty, yeah, it's very good to see you guys. It's great to see you all again. It's been a long time. And yeah, thank you so much for having me. Pastor Caroline, thank you very much for having me. I really appreciate it. And thank you all so much for all your prayers and support and just the blessing you guys have been. You've been a huge blessing. We're so, so thankful. And yeah, so today I'll be sharing a bit about what God's been up to in my life in Australia the past 6 months, and Shane as well will be sharing too. But before that, we'll just get into a little bit of prayer. So we'll just bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, you are holy. You are awesome. You are worthy of praise. And we praise you, Lord. We want to thank you for who you are. We want to thank you for all you've done and all that you continue to keep your hand over us, that you continue to keep your hand over us and just watch over us, God. You're good. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would make yourself known to us tonight. May you be present in this place. Would you encourage us and remind us of who you are? Would you remind us of who you are for and remind us of our mission here that you've given us? Lord, I pray that you'd speak through me, you'd speak through Shane tonight, and may you be the focus, not Shane or myself, but that you would be the focus and you alone. And I pray that you'd use this night to change us and grow us to live wholeheartedly for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Alrighty. So yeah, it's great to see you all. Very happy to be here. It's good to see you guys. It's been a while, so I'll introduce myself again. Caroline's shared a little bit about what I'm up to. So yeah, I'm Nader. Nice to see you all. And yeah, I've grown up here in New Glasgow, and we've got two lovely parents in the back there. You have in Russia. They're good. Good people. And yeah, so I've grown up here, and I just graduated last year at Dalhousie University, and so the past 6 months we've been in Australia, and with one of the, Shane is one of the guys I've been working with, and so he'll introduce himself to you. So this is Shane Bryan. Yeah.
Hello everyone, I'm Shane. Thank you so much for having us here. Actually, I've really never felt more welcomed, to be honest, besides my home church in Australia, but that's just because it's home. But I just feel so welcome here. I don't know what it is. So if here is a map of Australia, this big circle I'm drawing here for you, over here is where I'm from, and it's a place, no, it's over here, it's on the east side, it's a state called Queensland.
We can do two slides over. If you go two slides, we'll be in that.
Oh, there you go. So I'm from QLD, Queensland.
Looks like OLD to everybody.
Oh, down here. And yeah, Brisbane, or Ipswich technically, but that's where I'm from. I've only been a Christian for about, it'll be 6 years in September, so woo! That's a story for another time though, so we're just going to keep on rolling. I'm the only Christian in my family. I am the oldest of three brothers. I'm 24 and my youngest is 20, and my middle brother is 22. So great things God has planned for them, but we'll get into that. So, yeah. That's pretty much me, really.
Yeah. That's Shane in a nutshell. So, yeah. And yeah, so this past January, Shane and I and another guy named Tim, we started an internship with an organization called Power to Change, used to be known as Campus Crusade for Christ. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, it's an international organization, and they're all about fulfilling the Great Commission. And so in the previous slide, it shares just what the Great Commission is. In Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20, Jesus says, he came to them and said to the disciples, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." So that's what Power to Change is about. Campus Crusade for Christ is all about fulfilling the Great Commission on the university campus, in families, in high schools, and just in every environment, business, every different aspect.
Sports
as well. There's so many different ways that they're trying to just fulfill the Great Commission to make disciples. So that's what we've been a part of. And yeah, so we went to Melbourne, and Shane will tell more about that.
So our job in Melbourne was basically threefold. So we would go to university campuses to do three things. Find Christian students who are willing to share their faith, do discipleship with each other, and be keen about prayer. So that were the three things that we were really emphasizing in our ministry. I mean, there's lots of different ministries out there that do different things, and that's cool, but we really believe that prayer is super important, and that spreading the word is just as important. So that's essentially what we did, you know, like discipleship, prayer, and evangelism.
Yep. So yeah, that's what we were about. And before we go more into in depth about that, we'll just share a little bit about why we did that, and why were we starting up Christian groups on university campuses? Why were we training students to share their faith, to share the good news of Jesus Christ? Why did we do that? So one of the reasons was that Jesus, he actually commands us to do that. As I just showed you, Jesus, he says, go make disciples, baptize them, teach them to obey everything I've commanded you. And us as followers of Christ, as Christians, we follow Christ and we obey him. And if he truly is Jesus, if he truly is God, then, and he actually tells us to do this, then we should listen to him. It's just simple as that. So Jesus commands us to do it. So that's one of the reasons that we do it.
The second reason is, as followers of Christ, we're called to love. That's our ministry, the ministry of reconciliation, right? So love God, love people, love your neighbors, love your enemies. If we don't know love, then we don't know God, really. How can you express love if you don't know the lover of your soul? The Bible makes it clear that we're called to love people, and the best thing that has happened to us as Christians is going from death in our sins to life in Christ. So, yeah, we're called to love.
Yeah, exactly. And then another reason that we share this good news, in Proverbs 11:30, it says that he who is wise wins souls. So God sees wisdom in winning souls, and we want to gain that wisdom. We want to be wise in God's eyes. So yeah, that's one of the reasons that we're going and making disciples. So just out of obedience and out of gaining wisdom to see that in God's eyes.
Yeah, and the fourth reason is that because there is bad news. So there is good news, but there is bad news, and the bad news is that hell is real. And part of our ministry is that obviously we don't want people to go there. We don't want strangers to go there. We don't want our friends to go there. We don't want our family members to go there. So, I mean, that's the other reason we do it. You know, like if everything in us, like all of our compassion and our love, and if we truly understand what Jesus has done for us, then we want to help others see that and get them away from the reality of hell, you know? So.
Yep. And then we also share this good news because God is glorified in it. Us, Shane and I, all of you, we can't actually bring people to Christ ourselves. It's impossible. With man, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So God uses us, imperfect, broken people, to do his work. And from that, when we see these broken pieces, these broken tools being used to bring people to Christ through the Holy Spirit, through God's power, God is glorified in this. So so as we're obedient, as we're following what God does, what he asks us to do, he's glorified in that. So that's another reason that we share this good news. So yeah, those are some of the reasons that we do what we do, and just wanted to make that known to you guys.
Awesome. Yeah. So that's pretty much the reason why we do what we do on campus. We were at three university campuses. So one was pretty big. It was like a small city in itself. It was about 20,000. Was it 20,000?
Yeah.
About 20,000 students there. That was called Deakin University. There we had a really, really small one, which was about 3,000 students. So polar opposite. That was called Monash Berwick. And then there was one that was kind of in the middle. It was about 10,000, 12,000 students, and that was called Monash Peninsula. So two of those universities belonged to, well, belonged under the banner of Monash, and then the other one was Deakin. So, yeah, I mean, Monash is very kind of, they offer everything, really. Deakin, it's more artsy kind of thing. So you had some really interesting conversations on Deakin particularly. Like, we obviously couldn't have gone there without your, well, I mean, like, you guys are supporting NATO, but, like, like, we couldn't have gone and did what we did without your parents' support, you know? So we really thank you for that. We started off at each campus without knowing really anyone, to be honest, except for a few contacts that we had met through other students, other staff. So we're counted as staff. I don't like that term, but whatever. So yeah, we had like a small amount of contacts from some other staff, and then from there we worked with them, and we would go onto the university campuses and we would strike up conversations just with anyone really. We'd go on the campus and say, hey, we're Christians, do you know any? That we always did it a lot more elegantly than that, but that's essentially what we did. So before the semester started, we explored the campuses to get a feel for where we were working, what the culture of the campus was like, and how student life or power to change could fit in. On our first day at Monash Peninsula, we were at, so that's the 10,000, the middle one. The first day we were there, we were kind of walking around, getting a feel for it. And we were at the, like, the club's desk. So they're the people that are in charge of, you know, you're allowed to be a club or you're not allowed to be a club kind of thing. And we were there and there was a girl standing in front of us and she dropped her pen. And so obviously our first reaction was pick it up and give it to her. That's what you do. And then from there we struck up a conversation with her, and it turns out that she was actually the head of that club's society organization thing. So it was really evident that God wanted us to be there right from the very start. Like, we had an awesome relationship with her. She introduced us to some other, like, heads of clubs and that kind of stuff, particularly the head of another Christian club on campus. And even that Christian club expressed a desire to want to learn how to evangelize and want to learn how to share their faith. So it became very quickly evident that God wanted us there.
Yeah, so praise God for that. And yeah, when we didn't randomly bump into people of influence, we did something that we called FAST, which is a little bit of what Shane explained there. So yeah, we basically walk up to students and say, hey, my name is Nader, I'm from this Christian group on campus, and we're looking for Christians, wondering if you have any friends who are Christians. And that would open up a network of people, if they're Christian or not, or if they may have Christian friends on campus. So yeah, and it was a very quick thing. If they say yes, we'd get their info and we would carry on. If not, we say, okay, thank you very much, and we just carry on. So it would take 30 seconds to a minute. But it was very quick, and that's why we called it FAST. So there was one day where I was nearing the end of the day, getting a little tired, kind of wanted to go home, and I see this one guy just over to my left, and I was pretty tired, so I was, I don't want to go talk to him. He probably wants to go home too. He's probably tired, just ready to hit the hay or whatever. Just go home, finish off the day. But there's still kind of a tugging on me, and I said, okay, God, fine, I'll go talk to him. Although I was like, he's probably not even a Christian. And so I went and I talked to him. I said, hey, all that. And he told me, oh yeah, I am a Christian, and I would love to be involved. And he became one of the leaders on that campus. So it was really cool just seeing, as we are obedient to Christ, as we see him using us, even if we don't want to do something, God will say, hey, no, do it. And we just go and we do it, and he will use that, and he'll bless that. And it's been really a blessing to see what's come from that, the fruit that's come from that. So, yeah, that's one of the ways that we would go when we would find Christians on campus.
Yeah, so when we weren't trying to find Christians on campus, doing fast, as Nader said, we would do the opposite, and we call it slow. So basically what that means is we would go and intentionally strike up a conversation with students to try and find out where they are spiritually. Because you get like a whole range of answers from just asking. So our typical spiel or our typical introduction was, hello, my name is, and I'm from a Christian group on campus. I'm really trying to understand what the spiritual climate is of this campus. What would you say your belief is? Or what has been your experience with Christianity or Christian things or Christian stuff? And that just really opens up the playing field. So you might get anything from, yeah, I mean, like, I went to church when I was a kid and I don't have a problem with it, or I went to a Christian high school and it was kind of lame, or I've got some Christian cousins and they're okay, or no, actually, I really hate Christianity. So you could get like a whole range of answers from just asking that one question. And so from there, we would just continue to ask simple questions, because what we found is that when we ask questions, it's very not antagonistic. It's very friendly, very open, very kind of not offensive. You know, like, you're not putting them on their back foot or anything. You know, it's just kind of real chill, real easy. So that was the way that we did things on campus. Sometimes people would have false motivations and that kind of stuff. You know, oh, beauty, he's a Christian, let's try and trip them up. You know, but that was rare. To be completely honest with you, actually. So yeah, we would just ask questions like, what's been your experience with Christianity? You might have someone say, oh yeah, it's been pretty good. Why has it been pretty good? You know, you just keep asking why. Or if they said it was bad, why has it been bad? Oh, because this, that, the other, blah, blah, blah. So we really just adopted like a questioning method of sharing our faith. And then from there, once they had finished explaining themselves, we would go, oh, okay, thank you for sharing, but have you actually considered that there is a God, or that Jesus was actually real, or that, you know, God created this, like all of like the trees and the earth and you and me, like we're not just an accident, like we're made on purpose, you know? Yeah. So it was a very easy way for us to get a conversation going about God.
Yeah, which is great. It's very simple to use, and that's something you guys can even use as well. Mm-hmm. If you look at this, it's just an easy way to start up a conversation, a spiritual conversation. That first question, what's going on this weekend, is such a general question, and you can ask that to a stranger, to a friend, anybody, and often they'll tell you what's going on this weekend, and then they'll reply, well, how about you? What are you up to this weekend? And, well, today's Sunday. This is the weekend, right? So you guys are all here at church. That's part of your weekend, and you can include that into your conversation. Say, yeah, I went to church. I had a meal with some of my friends from church, and it was good, and then now all of a sudden Christianity is a part of the conversation. Yes. So it's natural. It's fine to bring that into, to go further into the conversation, and you can say, what about you? What's your experience with Christianity? What's your experience with Christian stuff? So
Sorry, I forgot to add a point. I'd probably say maybe 30 or 40% of the time we actually ran into people who had a negative experience with Christianity. And so the first thing that we always did was apologize. So we don't really know what happened, right? We don't know the reason why they're hurt. We don't really know if it's true or not at all. But we adopted a habit of apologizing to them so that they can see, okay, Christians aren't jerks, so, okay, I'll kind of listen to this person a little bit more. And it helps them to see that you have a genuineness about you. It helps them to see that you're actually interested and you don't just want to sit there and try and convert them, you know? Like, you want to show them Jesus. You want to show them God's compassion. Yes. So apologizing is a really healthy habit for you to get into if you run into someone who has had a negative experience with Christianity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. When we hear someone say, oh, well, actually, I was hurt by the church, and I was offended, and I left, and I never came back. That's a painful thing to hear. Yes. And so that is something that you want to empathize with them. You want them to know that if I was in your shoes, I would feel the same way, and I am sorry to hear that. Yes. And they may not have never had somebody apologize or empathize with them for that, and they probably had a wall against Christianity because of that. They said, I want nothing more to do with this.
That's right.
But when we do empathize with them, they see, oh wow, that there's actually Christians who care. Yes. So that really can break down barriers and break down walls, and mm-hmm. it's a very helpful thing to do, and yes. can really change the perspective that they have on Christianity. And another way that, other than them, if they ask, if they're sharing about a positive or negative experience, they can often come up with claims. And you can go back one. Okay. Yep. So if they're saying, if they come up with a claim, they say, oh, well, I actually don't believe in Christianity because of the Big Bang Theory or whatever it may be, they'll have a claim for that. They're saying, I don't believe because of this. And so from there, we like to, again, as what Shane said about questioning, we ask them, oh, what do you mean by that? And what do you mean by that helps you understand what they mean by that. Are they saying that because that's what they've grown up believing? Are they saying that because they just don't like Christianity? Yes. Or what is the reason that they're saying that? And so you get to find out their motives there. And it also helps them understand if they have assumed these things to start, mm-hmm. or if they actually mean what they're saying. Yes. Often we'll chat with people and they say, oh, well, I don't believe in God because of this part of science says no. I'm like, okay, well, what do you mean by that? I say, well, because that's what I learned, and they won't actually be able to back it up. Mm-hmm. And so with those people, it helps them open up their mind to, oh, well, I actually haven't really thought about this. I just assumed. So that can really open up to, yeah, I actually don't know what I mean by that. And if they do, there are times where they definitely know what they're talking about, and you can ask them, oh, well, how did you come to that conclusion? What came from this? How did you arrive there? And so again, that's helping them solidify what they believe or understand what they believe, and helping you know where they're at, and you can meet them where they're at as well. Mm-hmm. And yeah, as we continue to ask questions, and we'll be honest as well. If they ask you a question, you say, oh, I don't know the answer to that. I would actually love to look into that and continue the conversation later. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, those are a few things that we can be using, and you guys can be using in your conversations with whoever it may be. So yeah, again, our role was pioneering. We were starting off with just next to no contacts, and then trying to find leaders who will carry on the movements on their campuses while we're there and after we leave. So there was one girl, her name was Marianne, and she went to Deakin University. And so we had met her during the beginning of the year. She said, oh yeah, I'd like to get involved, but I'm not very interested. I don't really want to be a leader. I'm not interested in being a leader, but I'll jump in every now and then. So we said, okay, we'll work from there and see how we go. And so her and I went sharing, we went chatting with people about faith, about spiritual things. And yeah, she was really enjoying sharing her faith with these people and just, getting to hear all these different stories and hearing people's different experiences. And one guy, he eventually came to this question, well, what is Christianity all about? I don't actually know that. What is the main message of Christianity? And I replied, oh, that's a great question. Marianne, like, what do you think? Would you like to answer that? And she's like, yeah, I'd love to answer that. So she was really excited. She had this opportunity to share the gospel, to share the good news. And so she's all excited and ready. So Christianity, it is, the main message of Christianity is, Nader, would you do it? And so at that point we had realized that both her and I had realized that Marianne, she knew the gospel, but she didn't know how to communicate the gospel. Yes. And so that was a learning point for us, and I was able to thankfully share what the gospel was. But so after that, we had gone over what is the gospel, and I explained it to her in a way that she could explain it to others. And if you go over a couple slides, we'll go back one more. That's Marianne on the right there, just playing guitar at one of the conferences. But, and then the next slide. So this is a brief summary of what I shared with her and what she was learning. So the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, gospel means good news, and it's a good thing to share. So briefly in 4 points, God loves you. That's something that people need to know, that God loves you. That's essential. In John 3:16 it says, for God so loved the world, and he gave his only son. And then the second point is that sin separates us from God and essentially kills us. So because of our sin, we're separated from God. We're dead in our sins. And God, who's a holy God, can't be in relation with these unholy people. He can't be in union with sin. So that's a predicament. That's a problem. Because God loves us. He wants to be with us, have a relationship with us. How can he do that if there's sin in the way? So that's where, thankfully, Jesus steps in and he says, I see your guys' sin. I see your brokenness, and I'm going to jump in, and I'm going to pay for you, for your sin. The consequence is death. Our sin kills us, but I'm going to step in, and I'm going to die for you. So Jesus was he lived a holy life on earth. He's the only person who actually didn't deserve death, and so he was the only person who could actually pay for it. So he said, I love you guys so much, I'm willing to take my life instead of you guys, and you don't have to die. So thank God that Jesus died for us and rose again to show that he is God. Mm-hmm. And so he's done that. There's no more gap between us and God. We can now know God. Sin's not in the way, so which is great. However, that's not enough. We actually have to do something about it. We have to repent, we have to believe, and we have to say, God, I want to know you, I want to follow you, I want to carry my cross and actually live for you. So that's a brief synopsis of the gospel, just some essential points. And so I had shared that with Marianne, and that's also something you guys can keep note of as well in your minds, or write down or whatever, just to know how to share that with your friends, strangers, family, whoever. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I shared that with Marianne, and then a couple weeks later we went out sharing again, and we were talking to this one girl who was really enjoying the conversation, and again we came to this question, well, what is Christianity all about? And I actually got a phone call at that point, and I said, oh, I actually really need to take this, Marianne, I'll be 1 second. So I stepped out, and she's like, Nader, no, like, don't leave. And I said, no, that's okay, you got it, you can do it. And so I stepped out for a couple minutes and came back, and she was just sharing the gospel beautifully, and the girl who was listening was so, so excited to hear that. She's like, wow, I've never heard that before. Mm-hmm. And that's a story in itself that yes. People have never heard the gospel. But she was so excited, and we got to pray with her, and it was just a very encouraging time. And being able to see Marianne go from this student who was not really wanting to be involved to learning how to share her faith with people, and now she's actually one of the leaders at Deakin, and she's doing a Christianity Explained course, which is a one-on-one Bible study with a non-Christian, answering their questions, helping them know who Christ is and what Christianity is.
Praise.
So yeah, God is good, and it's really cool to see God doing that. But, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, we've got dozens and dozens of fun and awesome and anywhere in between stories, but for the sake of time, I'll just tell one more, and then I'll let Nader wrap up. So, this one, actually, it's not our story. It's our former teammate's story, Tim. He's another Canadian. Earlier this year, we went to Perth. So Perth is the other side of where I'm from in Australia. It's
West Coast.
If he's Australian, yeah, Western Australia, that way. Not this way, that way. And so we went there. It was called a vision trip. So it's called a vision trip because there is currently no student life or no power to change in Perth operating right now. And so we went there to see the opportunity. We went there to see if it could actually work, if God had plans for this place currently, or if it was still meant to be in the future or not. And so we went to, I think it was it three different unis? Yeah, we went to three different unis. And there was one guy there called Francis. And Tim had met Francis on one of these days. And he struck up a very interesting conversation. Very soon found out that Francis used to be a Christian, but 2 years ago, his mum died. And that really knocked him back a few paces in his faith, to the point where he actually, you know, lost faith, to be honest. But something very interesting happened. 2 weeks before Tim met him, he had been downloading a podcast about Christianity, and he was listening to this podcast, and he was actually formulating questions in his mind, like about God and about Jesus, you know. So it was a very interesting situation, you know, like on one hand you've got like despair and destruction and loss, but then you've also got like inquisitivity. So Tim shared the gospel with Francis. He was aware that he was not prepared to make a decision to return to Christ. Tim had kept in touch with him over text message, and they got to meet again before the end of the week, before we left. They again talked about the gospel and Francis's barriers towards Jesus. At the end of their time, Francis counted the cost and decided to pick up his cross and live for Christ. Amen. You can clap now. So that's awesome. Tim was just able to see someone come to Christ. But we really want to pray for Francis, because as of right now, there is still no student life and there's still no power to change on that campus that that Francis is going to. So please keep Francis in your prayers. Mm-hmm. Actually, is it, like, I know this is impromptu, but is it cool if we, like, pray for Francis right now?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
Father, we thank you for Francis, and we thank you, Lord, that he has decided to return to you. We thank you, Father, for new life, and we thank you for your mercy. We pray, God, that even though there is no student life or power to change at his uni right now, God, you would send people his way. You would send him a disciple or a mentor, God, someone who can guide him, whether it be from his church or someone at uni, God. We just pray for someone to guide him, to show him the ropes, and to show him to you, Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. And so, obviously, I'm reminded of the verse, Matthew 9:37-38, and it says, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few."
Yes.
And so we want more workers. So please pray for Francis and for more workers to be sent out to the field. And I'll let Nader wrap up.
Sure, yeah. So, yeah, all in all, our mission was to pioneer these campus movements, three university campuses, and praise God, we saw three real student leaders at Monash Peninsula. We saw four at Barrick and five at Deakin, who said, "Yes, I see the value of Great Commission, and I'm willing to step up and be a leader on my campus, and willing to actually go and make disciples and train others who will also make disciples on their campus." And we saw many other students say that they want to be a part of the movement on each of these campuses. Jesus, he tended to the multitudes, but he invested in the 12, and then again, he even invested in the 3. So, yeah, as they invested in others, and then those people invested in others, and that continued, and here we are today because of those people who had invested in more and more people. And so, yeah, that was, it's 2 Timothy 2, verse 2, it says, something about training people who will then go and train others.
Yes.
And so that's basically where we had that from, finding students who said, "Yes, we want to be leaders, we want to do this." And yeah, so that was a really exciting thing to see those 3, 4, and 5 students on those campuses saying, "Yeah, I'm willing to do that." Mm-hmm. And so yeah, we're definitely praying for them and just believing that God will continue to use them. And yeah, at the end of our trip, of our internship, or the first half of our internship, we went to what was called Mid-Year Conference, and so that was held near Sydney. And so 250 students from across Australia all came to this one conference, and for 6 days of Bible teaching and evangelism and training, and outreach as well, and worship, and just a good time. And it was so encouraging and so amazing to see, like, instead of just these 3 people or these 4 people on campus who said, "Yeah, I'm going to be a leader," but that multiplied by almost 3, I guess, to see almost 300 students together in that same boat realizing, wow, this is bigger than just me, this is bigger than just the 3 of us on our campus, mm-hmm. and just to know that. And then even going on our outreach with them, we all went to different parks and different houses, even just checking up on people, and God really used that. And even in that time, seeing students just learn to share their faith for the first time was very, very encouraging, and it was a big momentum builder for the next semester, because that was the end of that first semester, and then we had left. And so, if you want to go to the next slide there. Yeah, this was a part of Mid-Year Conference. These are some of the many students. I think you can see Shane there on the right, smiling, having a good time. And yeah, that was the big bunch of us, I guess. So. So those are some of our students that we got to work with, Marianne over there on the right, and Shane on the bottom. We had a lot of fun, and so it was a great time and really exciting to see them grow and be propelled into that next semester. We also connected with the coaches who will be coaching them for the next semester. We got to see the students connecting with the coaches at mid-year conference, and they had known the whole time that from day one, we told them we're not sticking around. We're just helping you guys, and you guys are going to be the leaders on your campuses. So we got to slowly step off, like back up more and more as the semester went on, and to the point where we didn't really need to be on campus, which was very encouraging to what's coming ahead. So it's been encouraging even now, getting updates on the internet, I guess, about the different campuses having events and having groups and praying and just doing God's work. So that's one of my biggest prayers, that they'll continue to do that, continue to build into students and continue to see God moving on their campuses, and just for that momentum to continue. That the students would depend on the Holy Spirit and play a part in changing people's lives for eternity. Yes. And even those people, that they would change people's lives for eternity again, and that would continue for generations and generations. People like Marianne, I would love for her to hear young people say to her, thank you for telling my grandfather about Jesus.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that's something I would love to hear years down the road, or in heaven, who knows. And yeah, I pray that we do that here as well in Pictou County, that we'd be willing to do the work that God has given us, mm-hmm. and to impact people's lives for eternity.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
And yeah, so I told you guys we're done the first half of our internship. We will continue the second part in Ontario. So we'll be headed to Windsor next week, actually, and we'll be there for the first bit of the semester, and then off to Toronto for the rest of the semester. So yeah, if you guys could be please praying for us as we go, and for the students, just that God would already be preparing a way there with the students, with the student union, the university campuses themselves, and churches around, just that God would be working there already. Mm-hmm. And yeah, just for Shane and I as we prepare, and we'll be working together, living together again for the next year or half a year. So just that God would continue to work in us and use us. And finally, for you and I, just to do God's will.
Mm-hmm.
Again, with Marianne, just seeing her again being obedient. She didn't really want to be a leader, but she said, okay, I feel God is telling me I want to be a leader, or I should be a leader, not I want to be. And as we, like God says, if you love me, you'll obey me.
Yes.
And so as an act of obedience and an act of love, to do God's will, to do what he wants for us.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, if you could be praying for us and for you guys as a church to do that and to continue to be obedient to God's will. That would be huge, and I encourage you to do that. Take some of the stuff that we've heard today, and apply that in your lives. The Great Commission, make disciples everywhere that you go. Share this good news, not bad news, not discouraging news, but this good news of Jesus Christ and his life that he's given us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it all starts with a conversation.
That's right. That's
exactly. Right. Yeah, it starts just one chat with someone, and it can grow so much from there, and you're planting seeds, and yeah, who knows where you'll be. You may even just have one conversation and never see that person again,
mm-hmm.
but even then, that's a seed planted, and
yes.
God will continue, will help them with someone else, will jump in, and so on and so forth. So I encourage you just to make disciples everywhere that you go. And yeah, that's basically what we have for today that we want to share with you guys. Again, we just wanted to thank you so much for all of your prayers and all of your support. It's been huge, and it's been so exciting to see what God has been doing over there in Milton. And yeah, God has really been working there, and you guys have helped make that happen. So we are so thankful for you guys. So yeah, God bless.